So last time we had introduced Hermite expansions. So we proposed some statement. It might be true or false, we don't know. But we saw from the examples that something is happening, right? So given a formula, you find its Hermite expansions, then say that formula is satisfiable if and only if the Hermite expansion is satisfiable. That was our proposal, right? So for that we need the Hermite domain or the Hermite universe, then that generates the Hermite interpretations, then the Hermite expansions. Okay. So we started with a formula in SCNF. So let's skip that. Let X be a formula in SCNF. Of course, any formula can be converted to an SCNF preserving satisfiability. So there is no harm in starting from the SCNF formula itself if satisfiability is all that we are concerned with. Then you say you find its Hermite universe. So let us write it as D. Then we have automatically the Hermite interpretation. So what we had seen is that if you take its Hermite interpretation, the map along with this, which we are calling as the Hermite map, should specify the predicates, how they are interpreted, should specify the function, how they are interpreted. But then here we do not need these functions to be interpreted, because the domain or the universe itself are having the terms. So f is just interpreted as f, and any predicate p is also interpreted as p. So we do not need Hermite map to specify those things, but we need it to specify whether any atomic formula is true or false. So that is the specific aim of the Hermite map with this. So here this H is equal to an ordered pair D and phi, where phi specifies how this atomic formulas are interpreted, either to 1 or to 0. They are either declared true or declared false. Some of them can be true, some of them can be false. Then we need also Hermite expansion. So let H be its Hermite expansion. So we just get the Hermite expansion from the SCNF X itself by substituting the variables with the elements from D, which are not terms, generated from the constants appearing in the formula and function symbols appearing in the formula. If no constants is there, we start with eta, some symbol we have started with, we start with eta. And if no function symbol is there, then eta is the only element in our domain D, right. If at least one function symbol is there, then the domain D will become infinite, it is denoverable, fine. So then we wanted to show the satisfiability. Then X is satisfiable if and only if X has a Hermite model. If and only if its Hermite expansion is satisfiable. This was our proposal, fine. Now let us see which ones can be dispensed with easily. Okay, we can start from the beginning. So X is satisfiable, then we want to show that X has a Hermite model, fine. That is really the main part of the proof, all others will be simpler. Okay, let us see the main part first. So suppose X is satisfiable. Now we can take X to be a sentence, right, because all the free variables are assumed to be universally quantified there. So it is a sentence. Then we need not go to states, we can be at the P place of interpretation itself. So once x is satisfiable, it will have one model, that is let I be equal to, we can't use that d, let's write say a psi be a model of x. So A is some non-empty set, psi is that map which interprets the predicates, function symbols and constants in it, okay, and they will map always to A. A is our domain now. Now we want to show that this has a Hermite model, okay. So where from we get the Hermite model? In the Hermite model we have the Hermite interpretation first, that should satisfy. So Hermite interpretation is already determined, d is fixed, once x is given d is fixed, phi is also fixed in the way it is, how it is giving p and all the predicates and the function symbols. Phi is not fixed only in one sense, that which propositional or which atomic formulas it declares to be true, which one it declares to be false, in that sense only we have some freedom there, otherwise everything is fixed, right. So we start with a let H be a Hermite interpretation. So H equal to, let's write d phi, where phi is to be defined, right? Defined for, they will be defined for atomic formulas. Okay, only for the atomic formulas. And moreover, in those atomic formulas there is no variable also, only closed terms can appear there, right, because that is how this phi will be over this d, d is having only closed terms now. So once you have some p, p of t 1 to t n and so on, so all these t 1 to t n are closed terms, there is no variable in it, right. So this phi is to be determined only for those formulas, okay. So you may write atomic formulas without variables. This is to be defined, fine. So how do we define? Well, suppose you take any predicate p, say let's say p of st, a binary predicate where s is a closed term, t is also a closed term, the terms belong to d now, because all those terms are only here, nothing else is there. Now how do you define p st to be 1 or 0? Well, we will define the same way as it is being interpreted here, because we want this to be implied, right, and this we have the freedom of defining it now. So we will define it such a way that it becomes a model, right, then it should comply with whatever this I interprets, is that right. So let t1 to tn be terms in d, fine, p be a predicate, p and n are a predicate, so define phi of p t 1 to t n, let us forget the commas, equal to 1 if and only if, what happens, psi of, we want to connect with our original model, psi of t 1 is defined, psi of t n is also defined, right, because they are occurring, all those function symbols are occurring in the formula x. So if this belongs to psi of p, if there is a complicated formula built up from this kind of predicates, you have connectives and all the other things, so the connectives are taken care in I the same way as in H also, there is no quantifier, right? So there is really nothing to prove. But then there can be free variables in X. Okay, so there only connectives are not there. For connectives there is nothing to prove. Only for the free variables we are worried now. In X, suppose there is one small X, a free variable. So that means it is universally quantified, right? Then you may have to do something. How it goes over? Because in that case, it might quite well happen that D is denumerable, but A is not denumerable. It's finite. Right? That is also possible. Then in that case, many of these D's are collapsing into that A because of this, right? So structure can be complicated. So a proof is required only for this case, whenever there are free variables in X. If there are no free variables, there is nothing. It is just propositional. Fine. So what we do is, but that is also not difficult. You can see for one step. For example, there is one for each x, x. X is a free variable there, so it is interpreted as for each x, x due to our convention. Now, you go for I satisfies this, that is given. Now, you want to show that H satisfies it, right. Then you go for every element in D, this is what happens. Now, if every element in D happens, then every element in T also it will happen, because all these T's are mapped into the D somewhere. Right, because of size are coming here, they are implicitly being mapped to D. Okay. So, proof should be going that way, but a formal proof will not finish with that. We have to start by induction on the number of free variables in X, right. So, let us try that directly. So, we prove that H is a model of X by induction on the number of free variables in X, call it say new X. So now if new X equal to 0, it is propositional, so there is nothing to prove. Basis case is clear. Is clear when new X is 0. So, X is simply a proposition, right? Only connectives are there, and these are 1. So, connectives will take care in both the things, connectives are same. So, in the induction step, suppose H becomes a model of X whenever new X is less than M, right. So, suppose our X satisfies new X equal to M, then X is same as for each X Y, where new Y is less than N, right. There is one more free variable in X, so call it small x. Then X is really for each X 1, for each X 2, for each X N, then some quantifier free formula. So, first for each X, after that whatever remains we call it Y, right. So, Y has number of free variables less than this. We are writing this way because each variable in X is universally quantified, fine. So, we can write X is same as for each X Y, okay, for some Y with new X less than new Y less than N. Now, by induction hypothesis, you get H satisfies Y. H is a model of Y, that much we know, right. Now, let us see what to do for H. Now, I is a model of X right. So that means for each d in A, okay, we have I satisfies x by d. Is that okay? Fine. It's not really formally correct. What we have to do is find one valuation there L. Then you have to take L x by d, right? That satisfies this. That's how it looks. Fine. But informally, this is what happens. Fine. When you substitute that x by d, whatever you get, that is satisfied by I. That formula is satisfied by I. That is happening. Okay. So if you write it formally, it will say you have to introduce one L, then put L x by d. That way. Fine. Is that okay? If you want that, then you may say take any valuation L under I. Now you say I L satisfies x, because x is satisfiable. So I L satisfies x. Then you will be writing for each d in D, I L x fixed to D satisfies x. This is how you have for each x p x. Now you say I L satisfies this. This happens when for each d in A, I L x to D satisfies what? P x, not for each x p x, right? It should satisfy p x. So for that, what we do, instead of free variables, you say universally quantified variables. Okay, that will clarify it. Then continue on induction on that. Then there is no problem. Okay, that is true because of the terminology. It becomes the opposite. Okay. So now here, what do you do? Suppose I L satisfies for each x p x, which means I L x to d satisfies p x for each d in A. Right. So here, that means it will not be x; it will be y. Okay. It should be y. Fine. Now, how do we proceed? So for each d in A, we have this. Now here, I L x to d satisfies y. Okay. Now this d is an element in A. Fine. So you can think of some term which is mapped to this d. Which term? It is that x. That x has been substituted in our Hermite expansion by something, some term. Right. So take that term, whichever is mapped. You have a d there. So you are really substituting that term in y, instead of x by d, right? That's how we can write informally as x by d itself. This is the reason. Is it clear? So you may say for each, if you write that way, it will become clearer. D in A, I satisfies x by d. So it is really x by t, and psi of t equal to d. So once this is realized, there is nothing to prove after this. Induction hypothesis applies. So the H satisfies this. Then you say for each d in D, H satisfies this. Over. Quantifier is taken care. Okay. So after this, there is nothing in this sense. For each d in D, you will be writing that H satisfies x by d, x by some term t really, right? you may say term some term t. T now, you can say t belongs to d. Now it is formal, right? So once this happens, that means h satisfies x. Okay. So this was the crucial thing in that theorem. All others will be easier after this. Clear? See, what you are doing here is you have A and you have D now. The whole of D is mapped to A, right? So for each D in A, this is happening. Then for each T in D also the same thing will happen, right? See, all these terms are given some values in D by I, interpretation I, right? So now for each D something is happening. So that means for each functional value of these T's something is happening. Okay. So now for each functional values of these T's, this thing is happening. Okay. So therefore, for T also, for all T now, the crucial idea is you have to see the everything of the Hermite universe is mapped to that domain of the interpretation. That's all. So there is another way of working around it. You just define one function mu from the Hermite universe to this domain D, then take mu everywhere, right? Work with that mu. Psi is doing that job. So once you realize this, there is no need of getting another mu, right? Is it clear? Psi is precisely doing that. It is taking all the terms in the Hermite universe to the domain D. Okay, so we are simply thinking of psi inverse D is here. All the psi inverse D may not be singleton; they can be many. But then, for each element also that satisfies. Okay. So now let us see to the statement. We have only proved one thing: x is satisfiable, then x has a Hermite model. Okay. Now if x has a Hermite model, then h is satisfiable. That will see. How do you show? See, suppose x has a Hermite model. Now we want to show that its Hermite expansion is satisfiable. So, what is the meaning of x as a Hermite model? You have the Hermite universe of the terms, or the closed terms are there. Now, those closed terms at the predicates, when you substitute at the predicates all those closed terms, they are declared to be 1 or 0, something is declared. That is what happening in the Hermite interpretation itself. So, after knowing that, you evaluate x, you see that x is satisfied. That is what happening, that is the meaning of the Hermite model, right. Now in HE what happens? Instead of evaluating there, you are writing it out in Hermite expansion. They are precisely to be 1, what else it can be? If you can see it, then there is nothing to prove, but there is still another way of expressing it. See, in the propositional logic itself, we could have discussed that. Suppose I is one interpretation, okay, in PL. So I have I of P equal to 1, I of Q equal to 0, I of R equal to 1. Now I have some formula involving P, Q, R, okay. I want to have a model of this. Assume that this is a model of this, right. I can write this model in a different way. okay. So instead of writing I of p equal to 1, I of q equal to 0, I of r equal to 0, I will write it as a set p not q r. I can just write this set, right. I will say that this is my order, they are equivalent, this is what we have done while constructing the normal forms also, right. So now what I do, I will even forget this q, I will say only p r, nothing else is there, right. So it means if you look at the formula, look at the proportional variables there, if that proportional variable is absent it is negative, I can put that convention always, right. So I may say that this model can be written as p r, nothing else, okay. Now in the Hermite model this is what happening, you are just declaring some of them to be 1, forget the others, they are zeros, right. So this is the way you are writing the Hermite model, and Hermite expansion is something like this formula, okay. Now you say this is a Hermite model of this, so that means you go back to this and that satisfies this, okay. Now when you say Hermite model is satisfiable, you just find out from this one of kind of this, is it clear why it is happening, okay. So is there anything to prove there, it is just another way of writing the Hermite model, that is what it says, okay. But you have to give the argument will go like this, suppose x has a Hermite model, now you want to show h is satisfiable, once it has a Hermite model then the formula is satisfied, it is inversely quantified, so it is satisfied when all the free variables are substituted by the terms from the Hermite universe, right. So their substitution is equivalent to telling all the formulas in H are satisfied, that is all. Next, if H is satisfiable then X is satisfiable, is it clear, well this statement is if and only if, okay. From H also you can go back, now then you have to prove only if X has a Hermite model then X is satisfiable, but there is nothing to prove, if it has a Hermite model, it has a model, so it is satisfiable, okay. So that was only the crucial step, first one implies the second, okay. There is one hitch in this, H is almost propositional, satisfiability of H is almost propositional, okay. Let us write why I am telling almost satisfiability of H is almost proportional, we will see with the region why this almost, let us take one example, say x is equal to p x x and not p f of x x and x is equal to f of x, okay. Suppose this is my x, now let us go for the Hermite expansion. So now there is no constant appearing in x, fine. So dx will be equal to starting from eta, but there is a function symbol f which is a unary function symbol, so it will generate all the terms from eta taking its composition with f, so I would get f of eta, f of eta and so on, all these are there in the Hermite domain. So then Hermite expansion will look like p eta eta and not p f eta eta and eta is equal to f of eta, right. Then p eta f eta and not p f of which name to again x has to be f eta now f eta f eta p of f eta and f of eta and f of eta is equal to f of eta, right? And it continues. It's a denoteable set now. Writing all these x as eta, and then f of eta, and so on. Fine. Now, is this satisfiable or not? He is satisfiable or not? Why it is not satisfiable? Because of some property of E equal to f eta. Now, when you are writing in HE, you will not also write eta equal to f eta, because equal to is not permissible in the expansion. It has to be written as E, right. So, you have to really write it as E eta f of eta, ok. Similarly, here also you have to write as E f of eta, ok. Now, is it visible? It is not satisfiable. We have to go for the properties of E, right. We know that if E s t is there, then anywhere s is there, you can substitute by t, right. If it is a predicate, truth will be invariant. If it is a function, it is a term, then those terms will be taken as equal, right. That is what E means. So, then here what we do is eta f of eta can be substituted for each other. So, I can write here f of eta, I can write this eta as f of eta. So, I get p f of eta and not p f of eta, f, right. That leads to unsatisfiability. Is that ok? So, h is unsatisfiable. It should, because from the formula itself we can see it is unsatisfiable. Doing the same thing here, x substituted by f of x, I get p f of x and not p f of x, fine, which contradict each other, ok. So, this is the meaning of this almost, except this equality predicate, everywhere it is propositional, ok. But then how to make it propositional? It can be done, there is a way, because E is an equivalence relation. So, on the domain itself you find its equivalence classes, right. Instead of domain as D, you consider the equivalent classes inside D. So, take one representative from each equivalence class, that is your D now, ok. So, that then induce one equivalence relation on HE. So, HE will become different, right. That HE is the Hermite expansion if you have the equality predicate. In that HE it becomes propositional now, right. So, sometimes in this theorem it is written as HE is propositionally satisfiable, that is the sense. Okay. So, once you do this equivalence relation or equivalence classes business, then you see that HE becomes propositionally satisfiable. So, it amounts to doing something in the proof theory, in the proofs. Suppose you have to prove something to be unsatisfiable. So, what you do? First apply all the quantifier rules, that is what we have done to find out HE, ok. Apply all the quantifier rules. Finishing it, you end up somewhere where you do not need any quantifier rules to be applied further. Everything after that will be propositional, right. That is what it says. So, in any proof system there will be a way to handle it if quantifier rules are separately given. If not given, then you have problem, right. So, it says you can have a proof system where quantifier rules are different and you can go on applying quantifier rules, then forget the quantifier rules, you apply only propositional rules, then onwards to show unsatisfiability or satisfiability, right, or even proof for validity, because validity and unsatisfiability will be dual to each other, right, or satisfiability, they are dual to each other. So, it will go that way, fine, but there is something else it gives, like you have H is propositionally satisfiable. Now, use the compactness theorem for propositional logic. It says H is unsatisfiable if and only if it has a finite subset which is unsatisfiable, right. So, now H is, suppose it is unsatisfiable, you get a finite subset which is unsatisfiable. That finite subset would have come from some finite number of formulas in X itself, right. If you have one formula, it is fine. If you have many formulas, for that you get the H E, okay, by taking their conjunctions. Then you also reach at some finite number of formulas only, right, which will be unsatisfiable, and that is compactness theorem for first order logic. So, it is very powerful in that sense, it can give you much more, because you are converting satisfiability of first order logic to propositional satisfiability. So, many of the theorems can be lifted now to first order logic, right, but we will do compactness later in a better way also from the proof theory. Then there is something else, it says something about validity also, right, if unsatisfiability then validity, similar way that validity can be propositionally done, first applying the quantifier rules, then propositional validity, okay, that is really the Hurwitz theorem. We will have some other applications. Suppose you have a set of formulas now. Let us say sigma b equal to x 1, x 2 and so on, a set of formulas. Of course, we need one restriction here, formulas having a finite number of variables having a finite number of variables. So, this means suppose x 1 uses say some variables, x 2 uses some other variables, even with quantified or non quantified whatever it is, x 3 uses some variables, if it is infinite it can be potentially infinite number of variables. Right. Now, you are putting a restriction in it, that does not happen, right. So, finally, if you go up to some finite stage you get all the variables, beyond that only those variables are repeated, right. That is what happens here, there is only a finite number of variables used in this. Then you can think of a Hurwitz expansion of sigma, because all that you need is a finite number of variables in the schemization process. If there are infinite number of variables, you cannot schemize, finish schemization, right. So, the algorithm will not terminate, though schemization can be done theoretically, right, but no algorithm will finish this schemization process. Now, if there are number of finite variables is number of variables is finite, then you can have a schemization process on it, okay. Then you can think of H E of sigma, Hurwitz expansion of sigma, similar to each formula you go on doing it, right. So, number of integral functions introduced to be finite, because number of variables is finite, right. So, the process terminates there for this schemization. Then this one is a countable set, right. Potentially infinite, it can be denumerable. If this is denumerable, this will also be denumerable at least, okay. Now, what happens? We say that sigma is satisfiable, if and only if H is sigma is satisfiable. Fine. Because for each formula you have a countable set, so it is a countable union of countable sets. Now, as a particular case, suppose you take a finite set sigma, then automatically you will get a countable set maximum, right? It is finite, then automatically you will get. Let us say group theory. Group theory can be axiomatized with 4 axioms, right? Forget the abelian groups, only 4. So, closed nets of that operator, right? Some group operator is there, then you have associativity, okay? Then existence of identity element and existence of inverse elements, right? These are the 4 axioms. So, 4 sentences can be written, fine. Now, take those 4 sentences. Any model of those 4 sentences is a group. That is what a group means, anything that satisfies those 4 axioms, right, is a group. So, every model of those 4 axioms is a group now, fine. Now, what you do? Applies this Herbrand's theorem on AND of all those 4 formulas, right. So, you get an Herbrand expansion. So, now you have a model which is countable, right, of those 4 axioms. So, there is a countable model for those 4 axioms. It says that there is a countable group. You do not have to produce, you do not have to really produce a countable group. It simply says there is a countable group, and it is an infinite, there is a denumerable group indeed, because there is at least one function symbol there used in a group, definition of the group. So, this becomes denumerable, right, like natural numbers. So, there is a denumerable group, that is what it says, fine. Now, let us think about something else. Say real number system. So, it has similarly axioms, right, some 11 axioms, right, field axioms, then completeness axiom, okay. It is a complete ordered field, okay. So, now all those axioms you AND them together, you get one big formula x, it has many function symbols, okay. So, now go for its Herbrand expansion, so you get a countable model for it. So, there is a countable for a model for the real numbers also, but Cantor's theorem says R is uncountable, right. So, what is R there? Anything that satisfies those axioms, then you have a model which is countable. How is it happening? This is called Skolem's paradox. There is a problem here. So, there are ways of explaining it, but not very satisfactory ones. So, one best one till now, the explanation is that yes, it is indeed countable, but the function which makes it countable, right, there is a function which makes it countable in the sense there is a map from that place to natural numbers, right. So, that map cannot be constructed within the axioms, within the system. That map has to come from outside somewhere. So, that means the cardinality concept itself is system dependent. If you have different system, cardinality concept will be different, right. So, there are something like you have empty set. So, empty set can be different, it will say, because cardinality itself is different. So, empty set which is having 0 elements can be different in different contexts. Okay, intuitively it is all right, right. You say number of people in this room having 11 fingers is empty set, but outside it is not empty, right. There are people having 11 fingers on their hands, right. So, there is some relativization of the concept of cardinality, it gives rise to that. It does not give a paradox, it does not give a contradiction, but relativization of the concept of cardinality itself. So, there are many non-trivial results out of this Herbrand's theorem like this. Okay, let us stop here.